There are four main points I'd like you to come away with an understanding of. What problems Mendeley solves, what technology Mendeley uses, how Mendeley compares to existing products, and I also hope I can convey enough information in this brief time that you feel comfortable talking to others about Mendeley. So first of all, who are we? We are a service for researchers to organize, collaborate, and discover research. The original idea came from two graduate students that were unhappy with how difficult it was to manage all the materials they needed for their dissertation. We've since grown to include over 40 people from a variety of U.S. And U.K. institutions. The headquarters are in the U.K. Mendeley has an office in New York, and we're seeing the strongest growth at some of the top-ranked U.S. institutions, like Harvard and Princeton and MIT, for example. Due to our academic origins, we've kept a really strong focus on the needs of the individual researcher, as opposed to trying to be something that would appeal to, let's say, an institutional purchasing agent. The idea is to solve a problem that an individual researcher faces directly. So that's an overall theme that explains some of the design decisions that we've made. So how many times have researchers downloaded the same set of papers, put them in the same set of folders with the same names? And how many identical collections of these same papers exist on hard drives all over the world? Wouldn't it be great if your reference manager knew what categories a paper belonged in, so you didn't have to redo what's been done thousands of times already? At Mendeley, we realized there's a great deal of knowledge encoded in how researchers organize papers, which ones they read, how they annotate them, who they share them with, and generally how they work with that information that they're experts in. So what if it were possible to capture this latent information, distill the trends and patterns, and make this information available in a useful way to everyone? Mendeley is in a unique position to do this, to leverage this aggregate information to help everyone who uses the software to do research more efficiently. We have big plans at Mendeley. In addition to the reference management aspect of the software, there's a social networking aspect, which makes finding new papers and potential colleagues easier by making documents, as opposed to people, the hubs of the social network. With Mendeley, you're not just friending people on yet another social network. You're joining collaborative groups that form around collections of documents, where those are topical, like a certain subject area, or temporal, like a conference or journal club. So Mendeley has two interconnected parts. They serve different functions. We call the cloud portion Mendeley Web. We call the desktop client Mendeley Desktop. And we just hit two fantastic milestones just recently. With the web, we have now seen our 100 millionth document upload. And with the desktop client, we have now seen just over 1 million downloads. So this is what it looks like. It's probably a familiar three-pane interface, with a high-level overview on the left and more detailed display as you go across. On the left are folders you've created, groups you're part of. Selecting a group or folder shows the items contained within that group with summary metadata in a tabular view. Selecting one item in the center view shows you the detailed metadata for that item on the right. A very important part of this interface is this little search box in the upper right. This provides find-as-you-type access across the full text of your entire collection. It supports advanced searching, and it's generally where I start when I'm looking for something specific, as opposed to trying to remember which folder or group that I've put something in. So there's a pro tip. Start with search to find things fast. When you start with Mendeley, you're not going to see what I'm showing you on the slide here. You have to get documents in first. So I'll show you how we handle that. We wanted to make it as easy as possible to get documents into Mendeley. The first case is just as simple as drag and drop. Take a folder or a set of PDFs, drop it on the Mendeley window, and it'll extract the metadata from the files and create an entry for each one. You can also add via the file menu, but you really only need to do that for your initial batch import when you're setting things up, because Mendeley can watch a folder and add anything found in that folder automatically. This means that most people just specify a folder to save PDFs to in their browser and let Mendeley handle things in the background. Many folks come to Mendeley having prior experience with reference managers, so we can also pull in information from those, either by import of common reference formats, such as EndNote XML or BibTeX or RIS, or by directly syncing with the application. Direct sync is preferred where possible, because not all apps output all the metadata that they store into their output format. Formats such as RIS are particularly troublesome, because it doesn't distinguish between things like author-supplied keywords and user-applied tags, and the format has multiple fields for URLs, which are used by different applications for different things. EndNote XML works pretty well, and I would encourage using that or BibTeX over RIS where possible. So let me just show you a demo of how easy it is to add something to Mendeley Desktop. I'm just dragging and dropping the folder in, and it's pulled all those in. And you can see that it got most of them right, but there's some that it didn't get just exactly right. However, it'll do a lookup because it found the DOI in the paper, and now it's corrected the metadata for that item. So let me explain what just happened. When you add a document, we look first to see if the file hash plus title plus author matches an existing document, and we match the records so as not to create a duplicate entry. A file hash is like a fingerprint for a file, and it changes whenever the bits that make up the file change. If you find duplicates in your library that have the same title, author, and DOI, most likely there's been some additional information added to one of the files, such as an annotation made with a third-party tool. In Mendeley 1.0, which was released today, you can find these closely related documents using our duplicate detection, and then it will allow you to merge them together if you know that they are duplicates. If it's not a duplicate, what we do next with imported PDFs is to extract the metadata, first look for embedded XMP-based metadata. If we can't find that, we'll look for an identifier such as a DOI or a PubMed ID, and if that doesn't work, then we can try to match title plus author and year against Google Scholar. So we use a multi-step process, and this gets the correct metadata from about 98% of the documents that we're faced with. Just to give you some numbers, about 20% of documents that we see don't have DOIs available, or the DOIs aren't correct. So we still rely a lot on the embedded metadata and text extraction, particularly for older documents. If the automatic import process gets something wrong, you can automatically fix it by doing a lookup via Google Scholar, Crossref, or PubMed ID, or Archive ID, or you can make a manual correction. Just click in any of these fields and correct the item. And correcting the metadata helps because the version of the metadata that we show on Mendeley Web in our research catalog is the consensus version taken from all the copies of a given document in people's library. So we'll get better and better over time, even for documents we couldn't initially get right. If you're browsing your favorite catalog, adding an item to Mendeley is often as simple as clicking your browser bookmarklet and letting Mendeley grab the information off the page. Mendeley understands most metadata formats used on the web, Dublin Core, Prism, Google Scholar's markup, and it can also consume the context object in SPAN microformat. For many databases, Mendeley can automatically grab a PDF of the paper too. If it can't find metadata, it will simply take a snapshot of the page and record what it can find. Now, depending on how you added this item, it will exist either first only in the desktop for PDFs added locally, or only on the web for things grabbed by the bookmarklet. So you'll need to sync the two by pressing the sync button in Mendeley Desktop to pull down or upload the changes. One of the easiest ways to get material in your library is to find it already in our catalog. I've mentioned the catalog a few times. I'll talk about it more in detail later. I want to mention something briefly about workflow here. The workflow I see most people use is to get the PDF by whatever means. They read it, they annotate it, add tags within Mendeley, and then they'll add it to a group that they're sharing it with. Or sometimes people add the PDF directly to a group first for example, to bring the paper to someone's attention, and then they read and discuss as a group later. So let me show an example of how this web importer works. So here is a basic PubMed search, and I'm going to click the bookmarklet in my toolbar, and it's going to go through each of those items and pull out the information that it can find, and then it'll give me the option to review the data and add those items to my library. So you can see that it's found all of the items shown on that page, and I'll just click so you can see that what it has found. I'll just click import here, and it will add this one to my library. And now I have the option to either go to my library and add some things, or if I just want to add tags or notes directly, I can do that right in this window, and I can drop it into a group or a folder from here as well. So that's getting material into your library. Once it's in there, you have to be able to find it. So let me tell you a little bit about the fantastic search that's built into Mendeley Desktop. Many of you have probably heard the slogan, search, don't file, from Gmail. The idea is that you don't need to do anything to actively organize your email. Just let it come in a stream, maybe use some filters on import, and then you can use search to pull it back whenever it's needed. We've designed search in Mendeley to be as easy as that. The idea is to take the work out of organizing and maintaining a collection. And you know, when you're relying on a hierarchical set of folders, this inevitably leads to dilemmas about which folder a paper belongs to and whether or not you should make this one folder into two and so on. And most of what a researcher reads, they don't end up citing anyway. So spending all this time filing everything is a little bit of a waste of time. And with Mendeley and the advanced search features, you don't have to. You can just let search do the work for you. It provides find-as-you-type results across the full text of the entire collection. And you can use search operators based on field names in the details view, such as author, title, publication names, year notes. And you're not limited to just those. You can also use tags and abstract and more. So think of search as a way to create an ad hoc dynamic folder of whatever query you can think of. So you can see how as I'm typing, it just goes through and finds all of those things. And if I click on a result here, it will show me all of those matches for that result within the internal PDF viewer. And I can press enter or just click the on-screen arrows and step through the occurrences of the search term. While you're in the PDF viewer, you can highlight text, and you can add notes. And an important thing to remember is that these notes are synced with your Mendeley account, and they're stored separately from your documents. We make a copy of the paper when you share it with a group, and any annotations and notes you've added to an item in your library that we're not in a group are not copied over. So feel free to make your notes as personal and private as you like. In the new version, you'll be able to see both public and private annotations on these files. In the groups, multiple people can annotate the same PDF, and you can all see it. Each person gets their own annotation color, their own note color, and the annotation notes are also timestamped and signed by the person who wrote them. So while in the PDF viewer, you can also create a new copy of a PDF containing these annotations. So this is how you write it into the file itself. And note that when you do this, it's changing the bits of the file. So if you then add this annotated file back to Mendeley, it will come in as a separate copy. You'll have one with annotations and one without. Okay, so let me go back to the interface and just point out some of the things that you may have seen here in the beginning. We have a star here. This is a way to cause things to appear in the favorites folder, just sort of an ad hoc folder that you can use. This green icon here indicates read or unread status. This icon here indicates that a PDF is attached, but it doesn't have to just be a PDF. You can add pretty much any Office document to this. You can add spreadsheets, text files, images, PowerPoints, etc. to the files here. So the interface makes it pretty easy to find documents, and we also make it easy to find specific files if you need to get back to the original item on the disk. You can just right-click, and you can either open the file in an external PDF viewer, or you can locate the document on the disk. If you use the file organizer, you can automatically rename your files, have Mendeley automatically rename your files according to the extracted metadata. This is a great way to get rid of folders and files full of things like download-6.pdf. And a tip that I found to be very useful when doing this is to make an inbox folder. Specify that as your watch folder. Download your PDFs into that. Then set your file organizer to organize your files, to rename them, and to move them or to copy them to a different folder. So then when you want to tidy up all of the downloaded PDFs you have, and they're all named things that aren't recognizable, you just delete the entire inbox folder. And, you know, bye-bye all your badly named files. All of the ones that are renamed and sorted and stored are in your library folder. Okay, so now we've talked about taking files in, managing them, and now it's time to talk about how Mendeley helps with the output phase, writing. If my experience as a researcher is at all common, grad students, they probably come to you when they're at the writing the paper stage, and probably not at the learning how to do research stage. So they present with all of the idiosyncratic behaviors and bad habits they've accumulated over several years. Often it's the pain of having to retype a reference list by hand for the third resubmission of their paper that finally drives them crazy, and they go to look for help, whereupon the first thing they do, of course, is Google citation generator or make my bibliography for me or something like that. And if they don't find us first, then they might come to you to ask about that EndNote or RefWorks subscription. Now, some of you probably realize that no one really cares anymore about learning the intricacies of MLA or APA or Chicago style. And really, handling the details of citation formatting is exactly the sort of thing a computer should be able to do for a writer. Mendeley integrates with Word and OpenOffice on PC, Mac, and Linux, and can automatically format citations in thousands of styles. When you install the Word add-on from the Tools menu, then you can just click the Insert Citation button or press Alt-M and insert a citation as you write without ever leaving Word. So let me show you just how this works. So I would do a search here for a paper that I've added. And I'm going to search for and it's pulled up this paper here, just found it as I typed, and I just hit OK to pick that one, and it's formatted it according to the citation style that I've specified. So when you get to where you want a bibliography, you just click the Insert Bibliography button, and it drops into bibliography formatted in your chosen style. To change styles, all you have to do is go and pick a different style, and you automatically get that reformatted through your bibliography and all of your references. It'll keep things numbered and organized for you. In the new version of Mendeley 1.0, we also store a traveling library inside your document, so you can share Word documents with other Mendeley users, and you don't have to make sure that they have those items in their library as well. And that allows you to more easily collaborate on documents. So These are all functions that EndNote and RefWorks have traditionally done for writers. But there's some issues that have arisen making people reconsider their choices and look for a little something better. First of all, if good free tools exist, why spend money, especially if all you want is to organize your papers, generate citations, and a bibliography? Another issue is that some of these other products are beholden to their large install base, preventing them from incorporating many of the innovations in user interface and user experience that have since been developed. Collaborative groups are an example of an innovation that EndNote probably would not have ever come up with, at least not in the way that we've implemented it. And in a larger point, there's also a growing desire to fix some mistakes that were made in the past that technology has now started to make obsolete. Relying on publishers to market and distribute your work is one example of a past system that's starting to not work so well, for which the new solution is open access. The solution to getting the tools of scholarship, the actual writing implements into the hands of scholars and out of the hands of big corporations, is called citation style language. So, like HTML, which specifies how web pages should look in a browser, CSL specifies how citation information should look in a word processing document. This was first implemented by Zotero, which is a reference management program that was a pioneer in open source reference management. CSL is now used by a number of services that need to display citations. It's an open format, which means that anyone can write a CSL file specifying how the set of metadata that makes up a citation should look when it's rendered in a word processing document or a web page or wherever else. And there are CSL files that have been written by thousands of individual researchers. The best thing about this is that these are all contributed to a community-owned repository. It's on GitHub. And there are many open source parsers that have been written that can read this format and then render the citation according to those instructions. So until journals drop the frankly ridiculous idea that they all have to have their own citation style, this helps keep the overhead of doing all of these processes out of the researcher's way. And it also helps keep the tools for communication in the hands of academics. Mendeley is proud to support and implement CSL. We actively support the community in further development of not only citation styles, but easy-to-use CSL authoring tools and style processors, all of which are open source as well. Now, Mendeley ships with most common styles installed, but you can add more, modify existing styles, or write your own. Because we've chosen to use CSL instead of making our own proprietary citation formatting system, the citation styles available vary in quality. But just as Wikipedia has grown to be more useful to more people on more topics than an encyclopedia, so we expect researcher participation in creating and editing CSL styles to yield a more rich and useful selection of citation styles that's more accessible to more people. And whatever happens to Mendeley, this will benefit the entire scholarly community. Okay, so that's what we're doing to make researchers' lives easier immediately. But all of that I've been talking about is really just a means to an end. We know researchers are full of idiosyncratic behaviors and settled habits, so we couldn't expect them to become social creatures overnight. But we can lead them. We can't expect them to just one day rise up and throw off the yoke of oppression all of their own, but we can make it easier with technology. Mendeley is designed to enable a more collaborative and social way of working, and to do that, we built the web portion of Mendeley. The web is three things: crowdsourced catalog of research, a social network that has grown around the connections that already exist, not expecting people to just make contacts for the sake of it, and it's a web service that gives out detailed information and stats on papers and aggregate information about researchers through the API. Researchers have uploaded over 100 million documents to our catalog. via the desktop client. This comprises over 31 million unique papers, most of which has come from metadata extracted from papers added using the desktop client. We've now also started to get some content from publishers who see our catalog as a promotional tool, and they contact us about doing a bulk upload of their content. We also collect the same content Google Scholar can get, documents from publicly available subject repositories such as Archive and PubMed Central. And we're currently running a pilot to enable sync between an institutional repository and Mendeley. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. We don't currently have any plans to present an OII PMH endpoint, as we don't really see ourselves as being sort of a one true source for data within the library community. But with this size and diversity of catalog that we've built, we've had to build a great search interface for the catalog to help people finding what they're looking for. And to do this, we've had to balance complexity with usability. A simple keyword search often works surprisingly well because we're able to use the information about the popularity of a document to rank the search results. You can do advanced searches to filter by a number of things. And there's a handy open access filter so that you know you can get the full text of whatever search results you find. Here's what a document page looks like. The basic metadata is on the page and also embedded as a Prism. Our catalog is public on the web, so it is also indexed by Google Scholar. What's unique about our catalog, though, is how we can use the data on readership and sharing activity as signals to indicate document popularity or infer document relatedness. The important problem that this solves that no one else really gets is the problem of serendipity, finding something you didn't know you were looking for, but it's just right. We show related documents on the catalog page. We also show tags that have been applied to this paper. You can browse the catalog according to tag and see documents and groups related to that tag. We show document previews because sometimes an abstract just isn't quite enough. You can email or tweet papers from the catalog or just click the big shiny Add to My Library button on the Mendeley catalog page, and we automatically add the full text for many open access sources. All of this is what makes the Mendeley catalog uniquely different from something like Google Scholar or Web of Science. Now, as another pro tip, if you add your open URL details on the account settings page on Mendeley Web, we can fetch the full text from your locally licensed source when you click this button on the catalog page. The bookmarklet doesn't have this feature built in yet, so at the moment, catalogs that used IP-based access for full text access don't work with the bookmarklet because the request will come from Mendeley's IP range. But we're going to be adding that feature soon. You can also search for people and groups on Mendeley Web by selecting the search type from the drop-down next to the search box. So I mentioned groups. The groups are an important part of the discovery aspect of Mendeley. This is where the social part comes in. You can create curated lists of documents, invite folks to join and contribute. In a group, you have two main areas. There's an activity feed that shows papers added to the group, and there's a discussion thread for each item. There's also a papers area. This shows all of the papers that have been added to the group, the tags of papers have been given, and an easy way to browse a group that has a lot of papers is just to use the tags that have been added to papers in that group. When you join a group, it appears as a special folder in the desktop app, and you see the same information there. Now, there's two basic kinds of groups, public and private. A public group is what I've shown you. In the public group, only the metadata and the catalog links are shared. The groups have a public page on the web where people can search for them, join, and you can even get an RSS feed or embed the collection on another document as an iframe. And there are WordPress and Drupal plugins that access these groups as well. But there are also private groups, and in private groups, this allows sharing of the full text of PDFs and other documents with a limited number of people explicitly invited to that group by the person who set up the group. These aren't searchable or discoverable by searching on Mendeley Web. You have to receive an invite. The functionality for these groups is basically similar to how researchers currently email PDFs around to their journal club group. All the major publishers are aware of how we use groups. It meets, in a conservative estimation, at least 3 of the 4 tests for fair use. And as long as publishers are tolerating PDFs being emailed around, they're also fine with what we're doing. And in fact, they realize that what we're doing actually works to decrease emailing because it's so much more useful than having all of these PDFs in your email. And this makes it possible for them to get an anonymous, aggregated look actually at the last leg of paper distribution, what happens after download. And we're also fully DMCA compliant, so institutions are not placed at any kind of risk or liability for people using Mendeley. So as I mentioned earlier, the catalog data is really only one level of data that we make available. Each researcher gets a personalized stats page, and you can see when I was starting with Mendeley and when I was working on my dissertation here, it's another paper I wrote here, and this is when I graduated and I did a purge, right? So this really only shows a little bit of stuff. We're going to be adding a lot more here. There's also a place to see general information about the catalog. Because we have information about readership at really a high level of detail, when you run a search, we can return more relevant results. We're always looking for new ways to use this sort of data and the signals about the attention a paper is getting to enhance the discovery side of the surface. Of course, this data doesn't belong to us. It belongs to everyone who contributed it. We're just putting it in a useful form. We're not looking to enhance only our product, but to return that value to the scholarly community. To this end, we've built an application programming interface to the data. You can programmatically fetch citation details, readership, demographics, and all kinds of useful stats and other information directly from our web service. Hundreds of applications are currently under development using the Mendeley API, and we're giving $10,001 to the best application. There are plugins for WordPress and Drupal. There's mashups for all kinds of interesting things. One app I really like is called Reader Meter. Using the API, it calculates a version of the Hirsch index based on your readership. So the Hirsch index says if you have 5 papers with 5 or more citations, your Hirsch index is 5. With Mendeley and Reader Meter, if you have 4 papers being read by 4 more people, then your H sub R is 4. It's pretty slick, I think. There's also a social graph explorer we've played with. When you search tag pages on Mendeley, you can see tag trends, related tags, popular groups using net tags, and so on. There's more cool stuff coming. Now, as I said at the beginning, Mendeley's always been about the individual researcher. Groups are a relatively recent addition, and they're really designed for smaller groups. We're talking lab or department-sized groups. There's no official way for an institution to have an account as an institution on Mendeley, but we have some ideas that we're discussing, and I'd love to hear any feedback or ideas that you may have. One idea is for an institution to have its own page where you can see who's paying attention to your faculty's research, who your faculty is paying attention to. You can get stats from most popular papers published at your institution or via department, and compare your faculty's readership with other institutions to see what impact your researchers have relative to other places. Or from another perspective, you could get information about what researchers at your institution are reading, which publications are being read the most, what departments are reading what papers, what publications are more or less neglected by everyone except for that one professor who sits on the editorial board of the journal, right? So there's some ideas that we have. I'd love to hear any comments or suggestions that you have. You can email community@Mendeley with those. As far as future plans, we are in this for the long haul. We want to be part of the scholarly landscape for years to come. We want to be around for post-PDF publishing and the semantic web and linked data. And the decisions we've made support this long view. Buying in the CSL, for example, offering a free client that does so much, and the client will remain free, by the way, because with the open API, anyone could make their own client. In addition to the API, where all of a user's data is available to them, we also support export in all the major formats, BibTeX, RIS, and Node.xml. So your data is available, and we even use SQLite, which is an open database format, to store our local data on the disk. So with Mendeley, there's no lock-in, because we don't want to keep people chained up. We want to help free researchers from the things that are holding back progress. We want to build our business by adding value to information through clever analysis and intelligent design, not by having people pay us just because it would be too much of a hassle to move to something else. We're involved in some forward-looking technology initiatives, such as the Open Researcher and Contributor ID. We work closely with the Joint Information Systems Committee, a major funder of digital initiatives in the UK. One such project is the Dura project, which I mentioned earlier. This is designed to embed institutional deposit into the academic workflow, minimizing cost and effort to the researcher, and we expect this to strongly increase repository deposit rates. So if you're as excited about the future as we are, here's what you can do. First, add Mendeley to your library website so patrons can find out about us. Next, integrate Mendeley workshops into your curriculum. You can schedule these, and we have plenty of resources from presentation templates to guides in many different languages, and these are all available in the Mendeley for Librarians group. We'll send everyone an invite to this group via email. And that concludes this presentation. I will hang around for a little while to make sure everyone gets their questions answered. And please send me an email. You can email me directly at william.gunn@Mendeley or email community. And please join the Mendeley for Librarians group. There are hundreds of your colleagues in there already sharing presentations and resources and all kinds of stuff. Thank you, and I look forward to hearing from you more later.